And if not, the electrons come in, and if they look into their failures, you see that out of this 44% of the failures, many of them are due to that immediate-related issues. The word as this group was not identified is due to the fact that it's extremely difficult to find, recognize once you open the device, it's extremely difficult to find immediate-related failures. Because by the time you open the device, the group is fired up. It means that any change that has taken place on the PCB surface has already disappeared by the time you open the device. Which makes it extremely difficult to find the corrosion-related failures when you open the device. And so the lack of understanding in the industry, and also lack of understanding that how to analyze this corrosion-related, industry-related failures, make it difficult to say that if one particular failure is due to that, and most of them are then identified as a root cause not identified. So many of these failures, as I mentioned, that is related to the humidity. When I say that humidity related to reliability issues of electronics, what I mean is that when the electronics is exposed, when the device is used at different places, different climatic conditions, where there is different levels of humidity, because of the different parameters, this humidity is forming a water layer on the surface. It may not be to this level of water layer. Here probably it's a little bit exaggerated. Maybe a thin layer of water layer on the surface of the PCB, at least as a transient conditions, and then it causes the problem because this water layer will act as a conducting layer. And when this water layer is acting as a conducting layer, it will create a kind of a surface insulation problem between different points, and that will cause the reliability problem. If that continues, it can also lead to many other failure modes, not just SIR problem, but it can also lead to many other failure modes. And this water layer can be formed on the surface. It can be because of temperature fluctuation. There can be temperature differences between the device and outside. For example, on a spring morning, when you go out to the car park, you will see that there is a lot of water in the car because the sun has risen. The temperature in the atmosphere has increased, but your car is having a high thermal mass, so the equilibrium is not reached because the car is cold and you get a high level of condensation on the car. So exactly the same way, when the device is used in different places, the device will be cold in the morning. At that time, if there is high humidity inside, then you get condensation on the PCB as I have shown here. So that's the temperature differences. Surface details of the laminated components. This also affects the water layer formation. I will show you that effect. And residue from the process and service conditions. That means that there are manufacturing process people use today, non-clean flush systems, and that means residues. And these residues can also absorb water very easily, and that way also can increase the water layer formation. So all these factors create the water layer formation, and this water layer will act as an electrical layer. And connecting between the points, and that will cause a corrosion problem. That's what I mean by the humidity related issues. So, why this is important today? Because everybody is looking for miniaturized device, and that makes the problem is higher. Also, the electronics is used at many places, all the places, which means that it is getting exposed to all kinds of climatic conditions. High humidity, high temperature, depending on the place it is used. If the customers are not okay taking care, you can also have a contamination which is coming from the atmosphere, and all these are setting on the PCB, and all together makes it a big problem. Miniaturization is reached to the level that, it is also connected to the water film formation. A small droplet of water which is forming on the PCB surface today can connect between points because the distance between two biased points on the printed circuit board today is so low that even a small droplet of water can connect between the panels. So that means that you don't need that much amount of water in order to get a cross connection between two points today because of miniaturization. Non-clean flush system is introduced thinking that this non-clean flush system will be benign to the PCB surface, but in fact, non-clean flush system will leave a lot of residues on the printed circuit board, and that can have real impact on the humidity-related reliability problems. I'll come to that a bit later. And You can see that also, as I mentioned, the electronics is used everywhere. If you take your automotive systems, every day the integration of the electronics in automotive system is increasing, and that's also the case with many other places when you see that where electronics is used. If you look at from the corrosion point of view, you can say that, like, you can simplify the corrosion by you see it on the circuit board. This, as I shown here, you have a lot of metals and alloys which is sitting on the printed circuit board. All these connection points on the printed circuit board is made by metals or alloys. And for example, if it's tin or tin alloys, you have the potential bias between the points. Because the PCB is working, you need the potential bias between the points. The humidity, that creates a bottom layer formation on the surface. And you can have the solder plus spring which is sitting on the surface. This solder plus spring will make it much more easy for this bottom layer to form, which means that when you don't have the first residue, you form a thin layer of water. When you have the first residue, you form a much thicker layer of water on the surface. The PCB laminate features also will affect the thickness of the bottom layer formation. Once this bottom layer forms, the initial part is that it will set a parasitic circuit between different points, which means that you get a leak current passing the solution or SIR eventually you get it. But if this process continues for a long time, and that can lead to electrochemical migration, which means that you form a metal dendrite between the short distance, and that way you get an electrical short circuit. Sometimes this electrical short circuit will burn off, which is like a fuse wire. Because of surge in the current, this will burn off and then the device will work perfectly. So that way, electrochemical migration is the most important area, most from a humidity related point of view, because it causes intermittent problems which other failure modes won't create. To impress upon you, that is, just if you look at, this is an automatic gear control electronics for the car. This had a very good encapsulation, which means that it was enclosed very nicely. But once, after a long time, the O-ring which placed here has worn off, and that created a humidity to enter into the electronics. And then when the humidity entered into the electronics, because of the temperature fluctuations, it caused condensation. So you had the condensation on different parts of these electronics. And many of these places you can see the corrosion. All these places where you see these colored P features, and those are the corroded regions, which you cannot see by naked eye. As I mentioned earlier, by the time you open the device, everything has disappeared, so you cannot see it by naked eye. You can see it here, because we have a method, so we applied some gel onto the surface, and the gel will get color if there is corrosion, and that's what you see here. The magnified view of that, you can see here all these capacitors. On top of this, there was condensation, and that created the leak current, and some places you can see that it also created some little bit of electrochemical migration, and that led to the failure of the device. That's what happened. So most of these feature failures are not visible when some surface is light, and this is visible because we use an indicator gel in this stage. So this is the electrochemical migration. You can also have many other failure modes depending on the materials combination that is used on the printed circuit board. Also, depending on the kind of environment, you can also have many other failure modes apart from the electrochemical migration. Electrochemical migration is one failure mode, but you can also have other failure modes. So, from this you can see that the humidity level, temperature fluctuations, and PCBA parameters, and that is one of these are the ones which is determining the water film formation, and this water film formation is the key factor that determines the humidity related failure problems. And which means that also the question comes that how to control this formation of this water layer? How can we reduce the water layer formation in circuit board, and that also will control the humidity related failures? So that's what I'm going to talk about, how to control the humidity related disability problems. If you look at the water layer formation, Vadimas was talking about earlier, talking about using Impedance Spectroscopy for measuring the water layer. We do a lot of work with the Bosch. Actually, the idea here is to look into the water layer formation in circuit board surface as a technique, and because in order to control the water film formation. If you look at the surface here, for example, there is no water layer here. If you have a very low, slight difference in temperature, or if you have a very low humidity level, you have a very, very thin layer of water here, and you have a much thicker layer of water, and here you have a much thicker layer of water, which is almost covering the electrons. The question is that, what is the critical water layer thickness you need for in order to create a failure on the electrons? And we see that there is a critical water layer which is necessary for the failure to occur. If you look at here, there is not, maybe there is a very, very thin water layer, maybe to the, it is atmospheric condition to the nanometer scale. You can see the impedance here. If you take the high frequency side, it is behaving like a capacitor, for example, the water filling here. Here also it is the same. But if you look at that here, as you increase the thickness of the water layer, you can see that when you look at the high frequency side, especially in the phase angle, you can see that it is changing from the capacitive mode to the resistive mode. Which means that you can also see here that the water film thickness reaches a level where it changes from the capacitive mode to the resistive mode, where the charge transfer becomes easy through the water layer, and that's the point at which you start seeing the failure in the electronics. And we try to correlate that with the DC measurements, and that's what Wafer was showing. But you can also see that when you reach that level of water layer, you also start getting the electrochemical migration, for example. And which means that there's a critical level of water layer required for the humidity failures. And this critical level of water layer determines that what kind of failures can happen. Which means that also the question comes that how can we keep the water layer thickness below this critical layer, critical level? And this is what we are trying to do with the water, for example. And when it comes to that, you can see here the other correlation what I mentioned, which Wafer was also studying. You can see the impedance curve here related to different level of humidity. When such kind of PCBs are exposed, and you can see the different level of humidity, the impedance curve. And the same one, if you do a DC measurement, you get this electrochemical migration at different points, different humidity level. Those are these points. So you can see that there is a very good correlation between the impedance curve as well as the DC measurement, where you would see that a water layer thickness goes beyond a level, those are the points you start seeing the electrochemical migration. So we have correlated that, and you can see a very good correlation. And we can also see that the impedance measurement we did in our lab, and the information what we get out of that, and also the test of the DC measurement part was built in their place, again we can see this correlation. Now how to reduce this water layer formation? And a lot of this can be done from the humidity, in order to increase the intrinsic reliability of the printed circuit board, a lot of this can be done from looking at a different angle. For example, materials or component is an important factor. Just to give you an example, the laminate surface itself is an important factor, because laminate chemistry and surface morphology, and that determines that how the water layer is building up on the surface, and that is an important factor. The PCBA design and the process cleanness together goes, because PCBA design determines that how much process cleanness that you can achieve, and so because of temperature profile and related things, and that's all first residue, and that's an important factor. But many things can also be done here in order to control the residue levels on the PCB, and that is to control the humidity or reliability problems. Lastly, even if you are doing this and making an intrinsically reliable PCB, still, if you have a very high level of humidity which is inside the device, you will not get the, you will create have a problem, because it's a very condensable PCB, which means that it's also important to look into the device level, that means enclosure issues, because enclosure is also will play a role, because this enclosure is the one which is making sure that how the humidity outside and inside is getting integrated, and that way to get condensation of the PCB. For example, the heat sink related issues and many things like that and related to enclosure is also an important factor. But I will not focus on this today, because the time limit, I just focus on some of the PCB related factors, how that can be controlled in order to increase the problems. If you look at that sort of a surface, as I mentioned before, here I just give you one example, because we studied a number of solid mass surface chemistry and surface features, but I just give you one example here. This is a rough solid mass surface, and this is a smooth solid mass surface. If you look at that water film formation, both of them, in this case, this picture doesn't show the electrode pattern on this laminate, but actually, if you put a electrode connection on the top of this, and that way while the condensation is happening, we could measure the impedance, and that's what we did. Significant impedance drop in the case of N with a pitch distance of 1 mm electrode which we put on the surface. If you look at the impedance drop here, for the rough surface you can see that impedance is dropping within 1 hour of the condensation. But if you look at here, on the smooth surface you can see that impedance is not dropping. It takes almost 4 hours for the impedance drop. What it means is that in both this surface and this surface, water layer is forming, and if you quantify this water layer on both of them, you will see the same amount of water layer is forming on both of these. But the way the water layer is formed on this one and this one is different. Because here, if you look at the schematic here, which Wally was also showing, if you look at the schematic of the water condensation starts as this kind of droplets, then it collides together, and then it becomes a continuous layer. If once it becomes a continuous layer like this, and that is the one which poses a problem, like this, and then you can have the radical conduction. So if you look at here, the water layer is forming here as an individual droplet because of the smoothness of the surface and because of surface chemistry, and which means that here the water layer is not connected. It takes at least 4 hours to connect the water layer compared to this one, it takes only 1 hour to connect. This is extremely important when you look at from the humidity layer failures. Because when you look at humidity layer failures, most of the time you have only very short time of condensation, and that's the time of time you get a failure. For example, in the morning, probably you have 1 hour of condensation, and that's the time most of the failure happens. And if you can afford this water bridging, transient water bridging, during that 1 hour of condensation, then your device is survived. So that's the importance of this one. So which means that anyway, if you can avoid the continuous water layer formation transiently for a period of time, and that's an important factor, and that way you will be able to improve the reliability. So this is what these people are looking for. Actually, they are trying to see that how they can optimize the solar mass surface so that this water bridging can be reduced, and that way they can get much more reliability during the transient condensation. So that's one factor. And that's what I said. It's important because the device during application will also experience only a short time this transient water filling formation on the surface. Another factor is this contamination of the surface. So you can see that all these are looking here is not the flux contamination which is coming from the solvent process, which is the residues are sitting on the surface. These residues are ionic residues, and which means that all these ionic residues can easily absorb water. For example, to show you that, for example, if this PCB is exposed to humid conditions, and then you could see that can you just click on this, the bottom of it. You can see that the places where there is a residue, you can see that it is preferentially absorbing the water from the humidity and forming the water layer, and all other surfaces you can see that usually there was no water layer. Which means that these residue areas are acting as a hygroscopic area, which can easily absorb the water, and then that way it can form a thicker layer of water. When we look at that point of view, actually I want to say that is when you have the residue on the circuit board, it can have two effects. To demonstrate that, I just showed this graph. This is constituted of using a sodium chloride. So here the contamination part what we have is the sodium chloride. This sodium chloride at different levels, put on this SiO pattern, then exposed to humidity. You can see the level of sodium chloride here, 1.56 is a middle value here, which is equivalent to the IPC standard. So if you look at here, when you wrap up the humidity with this contamination, you can see that nothing is happening under 70% humidity, but once the humidity crosses 70%, you can see that this leak current between the points is increasing. Now the level of leak current depends upon the level of contamination. The reason is that the hygroscopicity, critical relative humidity for sodium chloride is 70%, which means that if you can keep the humidity level below 70%, there will not be any problem. But if you keep that, if the humidity goes beyond 70%, it will be above the critical level of sodium chloride, it will start absorbing water, and then you have the humidity problem. So in effect, you can say that you can have sodium chloride, which is very aggressive thing, on the printed circuit board, it always you can keep the humidity level below 70%, because it will be dry, and you will not have any problem. So this is exciting issue, which means that when you look at from the solar flux point of view, non-clean flux system, these days most of the people use this weak organic acid based on non-clean flux system. But weak organic acid doesn't mean anything because it depends on the chemistry of the flux. What type of weak organic acid is used in the flux system, and that determines the reliability when you use that on a print circuit board and when the residue is remaining on the print circuit board. Just to show you, here you can see the impedance curve. Again, we took different types of flux systems. So here I am showing just three. One is adipic acid based flux system, succinic acid based flux system, and glutaric acid based flux system. All of them are weak organic acid based flux system but different chemistries. If you put this one on this board and then ramp up the humidity from this low humidity level to high humidity level, ramp down, again ramp up. If you look at the impedance value here between the lines, you can see that there is no impedance drop at all. Even though the humidity goes to 98% or 99%, still you can see that there is no impedance drop because the adipic acid is a very good flux system. And if the critical lady humidity for adipic acid is more than 98%, and which means that even at 98% level it will not absorb water, and that means that these results are kept dry. If you look at here, this drops the impedance little bit. If you look at this one, this is the worst one, glutaric acid. You get a large drop in the impedance when the humidity goes beyond 70%, like sodium chloride. What it means from the reliability point of view, if they use this flux system for their manufacturing, if this residue is sitting on print circuit board surface, the humidity boundary problem is not more than 70%. If they use this flux system, they can go up to 90% or more, still they will not have any humidity related problem. So that's the one which is determining, that's the way the residue is determining the humidity boundary for the failure. Which means that if the companies are, and this is exactly what we do with the companies, that is, if they have a choice for the flux system, which works from the reliability, from the solvability point of view and many other points of view what they need, and then they have the choice, this will work much better from the reliability point of view, reliability point of view compared to the other one. And equally the quantity, that means that the process optimization, the type of the flux they use, and the process optimization, this also can improve the reliability to a great extent. This is again shown in a with a SI curves here. For example, here the same thing, the earlier what I showed here, the impedance data, but here with the DC measurement, where we are measuring the DC current between these two, when this flux system is existing on the surface, you can see that if you have an adipic acid based flux system, even if you have 99% humidity, still you get a very, very less lead current. That is, this is 10 to the power of 5 milliamps, that's a very low lead current what you get here between the points, that's a very low SIR reduction. But on the other hand, you can see that if it is a glutaric acid based, weak organic acid based flux system, you can see that even above 60%, you get a very large increase in the lead current. And not only lead current, all the sudden increase in the current is due to the evaporating migration. Which means that you get a high lead current as well as evaporating migration in this case. So, just as an example, I took two flux systems here. But there are number of flux systems where they use the adipic acid, glutaric acid, not glutaric acid alone, but many other type of organic acid systems. So what I want to say is that it is you can control the reliability. There are many things can be taken. I just give you a few examples here, but you can have the many things can be done in order to control the reliability as I mentioned earlier. I didn't talk about the device this enclosure part. But enclosure part is also one of the things which you can look at, people looking at it, and that they also that part also there are many things which can control in order to improve the reliability. Just one point more, that is we also use this data, whatever we created this data, whatever data which you have seen earlier from this DC measurements and AC measurement, that's impedance measurement. We are also building in that it's another level where we also use this data in order to do a sensitivity analysis. Which means that today, if you know the print circuit board layout and the circuit layout, this one design, and then if they tell us that which part of circuit is more, they think that the problem more problematic, we could do a sensitivity analysis using our data, and then we will be able to predict that how sensitive of their circuit to the different kind of climatic conditions by using the information what we have. And we also try to correlate this information in the climate. So which means that today we are trying to analyze the climate at different points statistically, and that way we will be able to build up some of the information which is useful for the humidity reliability problems, such as dew point, the highest humidity level at different points, and then we try to correlate that with our lab scale experimental work, so that we can also then use that information with the device, the enclosure design, much more of the enclosure design in this case. With that, I just want to conclude saying that there are many factors that determine the humidity reliability issues, but there are many things you can take care and control this, and that's what exactly companies are trying to do. For example, laminate and component cells are important. If you look at it, the process and PCBA design, process-related residues and PCBA design, there's a connection. There are many things can be done there by process optimization and using the proper flex, which is the reliability, and design of the device, because that controls the humidity equilibration, and that way there is a lot of things can be done. And many times service-related contamination is also an important factor, and that we could also try to put the coating. And in other areas, putting the coating, there is no use as such. So which means that it depends on the, there is no single solution, but there are a number of things are possible, and if we integrate that, and that will improve the availability. All the work what we do, you can see in the site, circle.com, which is we are part of the Technical University of Denmark, and also acknowledgement to all of our industry partners and the consortium members. Thank you.